right, well, we can get started. It's 4 o'clock.
Welcome, everybody, to the August 16th, 2016 meeting of the Northampton Transportation and Parking Commission. My name is Ryan O'Donnell. I'm the chair of the commission. Let me announce the audio and video recording of these proceedings. And let's begin, as we always do, by just going around and introducing ourselves for the benefit of the public, starting with our vice chair.
I'm Jean Wayne
Shack.
I'm the Ward 4 City Councilor and Vice
Chair. Wayne Tide,
Planning City. Ann Brooks, Planning Board. Krista Burnett, Citizen.
Donald.
Excuse me,
Donald Gallia,
Director of
Public Works. Bob Powers, Lieutenant of Police Department.
Dave Pomeranz, Director of Central Services.
Maggie Chan,
DPW. Devin Eiser,
DPW.
And
Jamie Fisher, Resident.
Okay, thank you very much. We have a quorum here today, so we will convene. And we'll begin, as we always do, also with a period of public comment. This is an opportunity for members of the public to speak on any issue you wish. If your agenda item appears further down the agenda, you may wish to speak, to wait to speak until that time, or you can speak both times. The only thing we ask is you keep it to about 3 minutes, and we can engage in a back and forth with you, because generally these are topics we haven't posted in advance. If we're going to discuss something, we have to post them. So there's no back and forth, but if anyone wishes, feel free to step forward and provide public comments. Everyone might be here for an hour. Dr. Lowenthal.
Thank you. I'm James Lowenthal, 181 Crescent Street. And I emailed those of you whose email addresses I had about an hour or two ago, but I didn't have everybody's. I'm here to request that the TPC weigh in on the issue of the quality of outdoor lighting, specifically street lighting. The great majority of outdoor lights in any city, including Northampton, are for streets and parking lots. The main goal, of course, of those lights is to improve safety, so pedestrians don't trip over, running into telephone poles where they used to be for street lights, so that cars don't hit pedestrians in crosswalks, in general for safety, so people can see well. The whole point is the lights need to be well designed to protect safety. Lights that shine in your eyes, like this one, don't make it safe. This makes it harder for you to see. If you can see the light directly, it's glare. Glare is unwanted light that shines directly in your eyes. This makes it much harder for you to see my face, or if you can see the light directly like this, it's much harder for you to see me as a pedestrian crossing the crosswalk. There's an easy fix. You shield the light like this so that the light shines down only, instead of out sideways. The great majority of street lights now do not conform to this. They go off in all directions, including up in the sky, which does nobody any good at all. The city is about to install LED street lights that are very similar to this. There's a flat plate design where you can see the LEDs themselves from almost any angle below the horizontal. My request to you is that you take safety as a primary consideration and actually, through some city ordinance or other recommendation, request that the future streetlight should go down only, something like no more than 60 degrees up from the vertical. Now, the details of this are spelled out in this report that I've handed out to you by the American Medical Association. It's a new report that spells out why this is such an important issue. Many people, I'm sure you've heard from, say, oh, I have bad night vision, or elderly people who say, oh, I can't drive at night because the glare is too bad. This is almost always what they're talking about. It's the light shining directly in their eyes. That is the problem. The light should not shine in your eyes. And this is especially true for LEDs, which are much smaller than the old light sources we're used to. Therefore, they're basically point sources that causes more glare. This is a bigger problem, not a smaller problem, with the LED lights that are going in now than the old lights. Another problem with many LEDs is they're too blue. Fortunately, the city is planning to adhere barely to the recommendations in this AMA report, which says nothing bluer than 3,000 Kelvin, which is the standard measure of color temperature. There are lights available that are less blue than that, but not from the list that the city has already contracted to use, unfortunately. But at least we can barely comply with that. But I don't think the city is ready to comply with the glare issue. They can easily do so. I bought this glare shield to fit the lights that the city is planning to install. It just got this little, you see how thin it is? It's the same design as this. It's got these little tiny boxes that prevent you from seeing the light edge on. but it lets the light pass down the way it's supposed to. My recommendation, all the lights going in should have a shield like this. It'll cost about $35 a piece, which is 7% increase in the total budget. My recommendation is remove about 7% of the lights to pay for. We can start with the one outside my house.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Ms. Lowenthal, former Transportation and Parking Commission member.
And by the way, I'm still on your website. I'm still on the commission according to the website.
Oh, are you?
I'm working on that.
Okay.
Glaring error. Thank you very much. And we've been in touch and we'll follow up.
Great, thank you.
That's fine. Any other members of the public who'd like to speak at this time? Come up and give your name and address.
My name's Olivine Lococo and I live on Prospect Street. And my concern is the new speed limit is posted on that street. I live on a bend, kind of a hill and a bend, and you can't see anyone coming. And the new post speed is 35. I cannot get out of my driveway because of the danger of somebody coming around. We have had a few accidents, and luckily nobody ever got hurt. But I would like to see the posting, the speed posts going down on the bottom of the street and up on the street. It's a very different speed limit. It's 20 or 25, but this is now 35. So that's my interest because it's just very dangerous. There's some new trees going up as well on a tree belt. They're getting bigger, which blocks my view, and I have for the last 3 years talked to the Department of Public Works, and they're not coming out and taking the bottom branches off, and they won't let me do it. So there's another danger to me, too.
Thank you very much. And point of information, they just put in the new signage?
I think maybe a year now. I've lost track of that.
Okay.
But they're posted actually almost right in front of my house, both ways.
Even the white pages, can I find you that way to follow up on?
White pages?
You know, phone book.
What?
How best should we follow up?
Oh, I can give you my phone number.
Could you write it on something? And maybe,
okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, any other members of the public would like to speak? Okay. Then we'll launch into our agenda. And the first item is item number 4. The administrative code that establishes this committee that the mayor puts forward and the city council approves requires an annual election of officers. So section 1.09 of the administrative code. This commission has two, the chair and then the vice chair. And we could certainly have more, but we at least need to elect the chair and vice chair. So to begin that process, I would ask for a motion to open nominations for the position of chair. So it's made by Mr. Pomerantz and seconded by Ms. Brooks. All in favor? Opening. Opposed? Abstentions? Okay, so now nominations from the floor are now in order. So you can just call out someone's name if you have an idea of who you'd like to chair.
I nominate Ryan.
It's always an uncomfortable experience. Okay, thank you. Is there a second? It's not required. Is there a second? Okay. It's made and seconded. So my name is a nomination. Are there other nominations for the position of chair of the Transportation Board?
I move that we close the nominations.
Okay, no other nominations? Okay. Is there a second for closing the nominations?
Second.
All in favor? Opposed? Abstentions? There's one name in nomination, so a voice vote will do unless there's any discussion. Okay. All in favor of me for chair, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you very much. I will continue to be the guy to set up the video camera before the meetings and desperately try to put the agenda together correctly. So at this point, I would entertain a motion to open nominations for the position of vice chair. Okay, and second? Okay. 4 seconds, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Okay. Nominations from the floor, position of vice chair, are now in order. Okay, Ms. Brooks nominates Councilor Sharon.
Sure, I was elected this last year.
I know, you were. When you joined, now we have to do it again? Sorry. You didn't give yourself enough room to have time to get out of it.
I'll second that.
Okay, made and seconded. Any other names to put in nomination question? Motion to close nominations. Made by Ms. Brooks, seconded by Ms. Grennan. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed, abstentions? Okay, we have one name in nomination. So unless there's any discussion, voice vote will be fine. No discussion? All in favor of Council Chair, position of Vice Chair for another year, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, abstentions? Great. Congratulations, Council.
Thank you again.
Part one election.
I know. Thank you. So now we're at item number five. These are reports. 5A, approval of minutes of the previous meeting. Minutes are not yet ready for the previous meeting, so we'll tackle that in a future meeting. 5B is bicycle and pedestrian subcommittee updates.
Just continue to work. That's also the signs. It's working on those. It's like head master plan. One more meeting that's left, so they'd be doing their final draft. Thank you for the committee in September, so we get that on top.
Okay.
And then it'll come before you all.
Excellent. Any discussion?
What is the Cracker Barrel Alley installation?
Good question. So two phases. The temporary one, we ordered our temporary parklet and it gets delivered to DPW. You don't know if it's up there. It's supposed to get delivered sometime in August. Rich Parsley is on vacation this week, so I couldn't check beforehand, but hopefully soon.
Okay.
And then we're looking at the longer term in terms of permanent installation. So the parklet's along the street, but
right.
The alley itself.
Okay.
The class at Houston College is going to focus on next semester, thinking about that.
So, but as soon as the parklet arrives, it'll be installed?
Yeah, within a couple of weeks.
Oh, okay.
It's, you know, Rich's work group, but whatever his group can get to.
Any other discussion or questions? Thank you very much. Updates from the DPW?
Painting contract. Paving will start on Monday, 22nd. They'll be starting on Bridge Street and Bridge Street. Updates will be posted on the DPW blog. Traffic calming. I have collected data for Hatfield Street. I need to process that. I have counters down for the Main Street needs application. And I'll need to process that once I remove those counters. The Florence Road 2 speed tables will be installed via Cross Street. That's slated for mid-September. I've begun work to edit the traffic calming manual so that we have clear procedures. It's confusing now. As the manual right now basically says, once the application is on the prior list, then we can go ahead with construction. We don't need any more public input. So all the ones that are already on the prior list, we should just go ahead. The crosswalk at Pine Street at Porticelli. That was repainted to be 16-foot long stripes and pedestrian signage. And then the sidewalk inventory. Alta Planning Design, who is doing the comprehensive bike and ped plan, they were selected to do the sidewalk inventory. They should be starting now in the next month or so.
Excellent. Thank you. Any questions? And the other traffic calming applications that are pending are Cardinal Way and Federal Street.
Okay.
And I would just say, in general, it seems that we should do as what I think you're suggesting and take some of the traffic calming applications that have been pending for quite some time and think about actually making them reality at some point. Maybe in our fall meeting we can post that. Thank you. No other questions or discussions about DPW updates? Any other departmental updates? Okay. Thank you. So nothing under announcements or presentations. Item number 7 is a traffic calming application for North Farms Road, which was received March 21st, 2016. Is there anyone here to speak to that today?
I was in touch by one of the signatories of the traffic calming application, Amy Levine, who requested that we actually do this at our September meeting. So it doesn't appear that anyone here for that item, so unless there's any objection, we'll take that up to our next meeting instead. Okay. Here's some ordinances and, you know, a lot of other stuff, but I see there are many people here who I think they're here for Hampton Avenue crosswalk, so unless there's any objection from the commission, I'd like to move that item up out of respect for their time. We don't have to skip that many to get there anyway. This is item number 9A. Recommendation on the installation of a new crosswalk on Hampton Avenue. And the way I was just doing this is, since the DPW, with our traffic engineer, has developed criteria which didn't exist before for the installation of mid-block crosswalks, and applied that criteria in a study and analysis of this particular location, I'd like to ask first of our traffic engineer or DPW director could explain that study and the new criteria. I would suggest we then have some discussion amongst the commission about what we hear. I'd like to shift then to the public and allow for a period of public comment. And then I'd like to come back to the commission for a final discussion and a vote. I'm trying to keep things orderly while giving everyone an opportunity to speak their mind. So that's what I suggest. And if that's okay, I would ask the DPW director or traffic engineer to lead us off in the session.
Basically, in the past, whenever a mid-block request was made, it was just rejected that way.
Can you speak louder, maybe?
We can't hear you at all.
So, in the past, when a mid-block crosswalk was requested, the previous DPW director would reject that because of safety issues at other mid-block crosswalks. And the resident who requested the crosswalk for Hampton Avenue asked why and what's the reasoning, and we didn't really have any besides that safety issue. So I looked into other cities to see what they've been doing, and I used the City of Brookline's crosswalk criteria, and they have, their criteria is the 85th percentile, the number of pedestrians who cross the street, the average daily traffic, if there is an adequate sidewalk or shoulder, if there is a crosswalk within 300 feet, if there's adequate lighting and adequate sight stopping distances. And based on all that data that I've collected, it's all the criteria that said yes, yeah, it's warranted that a crosswalk can be installed at that location. That location is at the access road for the parking garage and not directly in front of Hampton Courts, because that is within 300 feet of the other crosswalk at Pleasant Street.
Let me start by saying thank you for doing that work. I think it's great to have developed this policy. It's something we needed. And I admire how you went about doing that, so thank you very much. Were there any general comments from the commission start, Director Fyler?
So I'm totally in favor of this crosswalk. I like the methodology it went through. I guess the only question I have is, I'm totally in favor of this one in part because even though it's technically an access driveway, it looks and feels to drivers like it's a street that's coming in. So that makes me particularly comfortable here. I just want to caution before we apply this all over the city. I'd love to test it in other sites before. So it may be great, but for this site, great, and we can have a discussion next time.
This is not our policy. It's borrowing from the line until we develop the policy.
That's my comment. Otherwise, it's great. Thank you so much for doing this.
Maggie, just when you look at Brookline, is there any different design criteria for the actual crosswalks that they end up doing mid-block? There was a crosswalk wider, raised, anything like that, that you can't put any information with other cities?
I think that depending on the location, could be longer lengths. So on a side street, it might be 8 foot wide. At a mid-block, we would probably install a 16 foot wide sidewalk.
Any other additions to just across the paint, the color, is it raised, cut across?
Nothing
Just curious.
Any other?
Was Brookline the only criteria that you found, or were there other municipalities that had them, or was Brookline just the most similar to us, and that's why it made sense to adopt theirs now?
Yeah, Brookline was probably the first policy that I found, so I worked off of that one. There are others around the United States, but since Brookline is in Massachusetts, I have to follow that one.
Anyone else? Actually, taking, leading off from what Director Pomerantz said, I do think it would be helpful or beneficial for us to discuss those kind of mitigation techniques we could apply to this crosswalk. And it's actually, I guess, good that we don't, I thought this kind of was our policy. It's good that it's still in flux, because we should discuss it and see what is best for Northampton. But I think that when you add a crosswalk, especially a mid-block crosswalk, mid-block crosswalk, I think, was frowned upon. Or, you know, Director Ned Hundley would always just say, we frown on those. And I think the reason is because they're just totally unexpected. And I take Director Fine's point that it looks, it doesn't just look like you're in the middle of a block, because there actually is a road there that people use all the time, and essentially it is kind of an intersection, which is good. But I think we should discuss some of the additional things we're going to have on the crosswalk. For example, are we going to have those yield triangles a certain distance from the crosswalk? What kind of paint will we use? Actually, it's good to hear that it's going to be a wider crosswalk than just what you would have up at Pleasant Street, for example. I think we should have, if it's not already required by federal standards, we should have a pedestrian crossing paddle in the middle of it, in the street. And I think that, you know, if we plan in the future, I'm not sure when this is going to be actually built, but as we develop a plan for this area, I think we should look at the curb and if we're ever going to build the sidewalks. And the sidewalks down near the radio station surely need to be rebuilt. If we ever rebuild them the whole width of the block, could we make could we decrease the radius, the turning radius of the curb, the slow traffic there, and those kinds of considerations. I think those are important to discuss. Maybe we can do a little bit of that today.
How wide is the street, Mary? The question of mid-street crossing comes up a lot when we're putting stuff in on the planning board kind of applications. And to the extent that we are trying to encourage walking, we're going to run into more and more places where there's a desire to be able to get to the other side of the street, because maybe that's what the sidewalks are, or because that's where activities or something else are. So I'm thinking that it's not a one-off, and that it does need some kind of policies, and that there ought not to be a just, we don't want to do this kind of a process, because I think increasing walking is going to require, with some long blocks, that we do more of this. So I concur that we really ought to look at the variables and try to package them up in some way.
Anyone else?
Is there like a general rule a reason when you would use a paddle in the middle of the cross? I notice we don't use them very often. So is there a criteria for using them?
Not a criteria. They're expensive, and normally it's how they can be purchased. Around the city, there were some that were owned by the DPW, some were donated by the Elks or the Lions, one of those type of clubs. They were on them, and we would take them in the winter and try to put them back out during the better months. But increasingly, we take in less than we would be putting out. So that would be something that would be involve funding or donations. But with them out there, I think they do bring people's eye to the fact that it's not an open road.
Maggie, when you were doing the counts of crossings, you essentially were recording them through the whole width of the block, is that right? So people were essentially crossing at many different points between Hampton Court and the parking lot.
They didn't cross at only one location. It varied. People crossed wherever they wanted. Mostly in front of Hampton Court. That was the desired line. However, a crossing there would be too close to the other one down Pleasant Street. So
and too close because of necessary stopping distance of your car.
Right.
Which is 300 feet. So that's right. What we're deciding to use. But that seems like a fairly universal standard from what I've read, not just in Brookline, but other places. A reasonable standard. And I think one of the things that people look at in mid-block crossings is whether or not these ultimately become used or not, whether they kind of channelize people and create an incentive or, I don't know, create a place where crossing becomes more common, so it becomes less random and you're less kind of dashing out into traffic to cross the street. So to Ms. Brooks' point, one thing that I would be curious in, even after we have a policy, I think that, and this requires effort, requires follow-up and expense, but I think that we should, any recommendation today should come with a parallel recommendation to follow up on it. I mean, shouldn't we be doing an analysis of how something to build is used? So I'd like to make that suggestion.
Gotta give it some time.
Give it some time, you know, once it's built, you know, but is it used, you know? For me, the concerns that I'm weighing, and this has always just been nothing but safety. That's the entire issue. And you can understand why, because we've had real tragedies in crosswalks in Northampton. And so I appreciate the deliberation that DPW has gone through, and this commission has undertaken. It's critical. So I would like to do that kind of follow-up. The basic thing for me is, are we in any way decreasing safety? Because crosswalks are unexpected. Mid-block crosswalks are unexpected. Because pedestrians might have an artificial sense of confidence by stepping out into a marked as opposed to an unmarked crossing. And so that's the kind of standard that I've been using to weigh whether or not this is the right thing.
I guess I'd just like to throw something else out into the mix here. It's the middle of August, and if we wanted to do some more investigative work, would it be the intent to try to do something before winter sets in, either on a permanent or temporary basis? Does it make sense to do something on a temporary basis as a trial to see if there's pluses and minuses to doing something mid-block in that area, regardless of the weather? And if we were to do something on a temporary basis once weather sets in and we're dealing with snowbanks, is it the right time of the year to try something? So I guess I'll just throw those out. Consideration.
How easy is it to do something on a temporary basis if you have to do the curb cuts? Right.
I think it's either a yes or a no. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if you can do a temporary crosswalk there without doing the curb cuts. For people to be
course, of residents to speak to it, but did you have any numbers on disabled individuals going into the road? I mean, did you observe any of that? Not that I doubt it, I'm just curious.
I don't have exact numbers, but I did see 20 wheelchairs and elderly crossing the road.
Any other initial thoughts or discussion?
I don't think you can legally make a crosswalk that's not accessible.
Oh, right. No, we wouldn't. Well, maybe it's the right time to ask for public comment on the plan. And I would ask anyone who would like to
provide your thoughts. Has everyone seen the study? Yeah, okay. I'm seeing yes, so no particular order. Feel free to comment. Let us know what you think.
I'll kick it off. Zane Lemelski, I live at 20 Hampton Avenue. I'm also the president of the Hampton Court Community Association. So, some of my neighbors are going to want to say something too. But I have a couple questions and then some comments. Some simple questions. One question is, and Ms. Chang, first of all, I agree with everyone who complimented you. It was a very professional, thorough job. Needed to be done. I wasn't aware that there was a traffic count on Hampton Court in decades. So for various reasons, I think that's good. A couple technical questions. Did you say that the crosswalk would be 16 feet wide, not 18 feet?
16 feet, yes.
16?
Yes, that's city standard.
Okay. The existing crosswalks are mostly 8 feet, and Brookline says 8 feet in this kind of a road.
8 feet for a side street.
Right. So you don't consider this, you consider this an arterial or a collector road?
I mean, by side street, I mean like if you're going off from
Brookline. So Brookline said recommends 8 feet
right.
For this type of road, or for an arterial or collector road, 10 feet. But that's not a.
As long as we're going back and forth, what would be the downside of a wider crosswalk from your perspective?
I don't know. I just want clarification because
okay.
we're using this Brookline as a guide. Brookline. Just to address the temporary, maybe Wayne already said it, it wouldn't work. I don't think it would be a good idea. And one of the reasons is, and I want to remind everybody, besides the fact that a lot of people cross from Hampton Court and the businesses and the residents, there are over 150 residents, six or seven businesses, guests, a big concern, an additional big concern of ours would be the number of people in wheelchairs and walkers. Now that population varies a lot. Currently we have two wheelchairs. We have had as many as five or six. Right now we have six or eight people with walkers.
We have three wheelchairs.
Oh, Mike's back. Okay, so we have three. Sorry. It varies. We also have children. We have two new babies, people with wheelchair, with strollers, et cetera. The width of Hampton Avenue, I think, it's not 30 feet, it's closer to 15. It's a very narrow road. One suggestion was to put parking as a common, but it would be tough. You know, it's not a very wide road. Somewhere between 15 and 20. It's not 30. The other reason that we were requesting this is in the wintertime, there's no, except at the very ends, people use the driveway to cross because of the snowbanks. So we're saying a snowbank would be, or if there's a crosswalk with a ramp, the owners would be required to clear that, make that accessible. So that was another reason we were asking for it. So I don't want to say anything to dissuade you from saying yes to this location. However, I do have a pretty significant concern about this location. It's just that people don't cross there. People cross where we said the primary location was. I think Ms. Chang, you know, pointed that out. They could be crossing a couple of feet away, different places, but it's generally that location. People are either going to Main Street or King Street or the CVS or even to the farmer's market or the Thorns. Certainly people cross at other areas, but that seems to be the main thing. So my big concern is that we put a crosswalk down at, and it, the city identifies that as a street, Kirkland Street, not an access road. So I even have qualms about, you know, calling it a mid-block because it's on the official city documents, that's a street. Anyway, the you know, I wouldn't want to discourage a crosswalk anywhere, because a crosswalk somewhere is certainly going to help a lot of people who are crossing that street, especially wheelchair walkers in the wintertime. But to get people to change their habits and then to cross down in an area that is counterintuitive, I've been using the location that you're requesting for the last couple months when I come out of Thorns or Tuesday Market. And, you know, it's fine, it's shadier, you know, it's no big deal, maybe, but it takes you in a different direction for a little bit. It veers off to the west and you're going east. So because of that, I looked at the Brookline's criteria a little more closely. And the condition that Ms. Chang followed was appropriate. It was section 4.2 for non-school crossings. And that criteria, both locations that we suggested met all the criteria, except the location that we preferred didn't meet one, which is within 300 feet. The other situations that Brookline talks about, they're all 200 feet. And so we did a couple things. We actually physically measured the distance between the Pleasant Street crosswalk and our preferred location, and it was 198 feet 6 inches. And we measured it from the closest edges of the crosswalk. So I don't know if you measure from the center point of the crosswalk. If you do, then you'd add another 8 feet. And then the other thought that one of my residents had was, what if we had, we were suggesting a crosswalk as you're facing downtown to the right of that road, and if it was on the left, it would certainly meet the 200 criteria. So I contacted Brookline, their highway department, and everybody was on vacation, unfortunately. But I explained what I was looking at and my question, and they suggested that I email the transportation administrator. His name is Todd Corrine. And Mr. Corrine kindly emailed me right away back. And my question to him was, do you ever make exceptions to the 300-foot rule, or even the 200-foot rule? And his response was, yes, we use these guidelines and have made exceptions where there are destination points, schools, commercial areas, etc., that warrant the exception based on use. The biggest thing we look at is making sure there is enough sight lines for the speed of the roadway. And this report indicates that there are. And also, if you recall my initial presentation, we felt the sight lines at the point where you're talking about now are not as clear and as good as the location we talked about because of the curve or the bend of the road. And it's also a longer distance. Actually, I did prepare these just to show you the distances. The Google map, obviously, are going to be a little bit approximate. I'm using a Google scale, so the dots are every 50 feet. But the measured distances, we literally measured. So, just to reiterate, I don't want my qualms to obstruct your decision to include a crosswalk somewhere, but I still would encourage you to, especially considering that safety is the biggest issue, that our preferred location would probably be safer in the end. The other thing that I'm not sure the study counted was the number of vehicles in and out of the driveways, both to the Armory parking lot and to the garage. I think that would be helpful. Anecdotal information from parking garage people feel that that is a more traveled driveway than the Armory driveway. I didn't imagine I'd become so engrossed in crosswalks and traffic, but Chief Casper recommended I read Traffic. I don't know if many of you have read that book from 08. I recommended a book to her, and I've been doing a lot of research in crosswalks. And the thing is, it's inconclusive whether crosswalks are more dangerous or less dangerous. And I'll continue to do more research, but I would contend that the question is still out. I asked a couple people. I have a contact at the Federal Highway Administration in Boston. His comment was, you know, it's still up for discussion. And so I want you to remember that we're not asking it just for people who can walk easily, but also for people in wheelchairs who really need a ramp to get across the street. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Would anyone else like to comment? Please.
Yeah, I have a comment. Dominic DeMar, 20 Hampton Avenue. I just come here. I'm one of those wheelchair people. And I don't think we need a paddle at all. A paddle? To stop, make people, to make cars stop? No. I don't think so. What we need is a big panel that says, walking, you know, the people walking on the crosswalk with lights that can be coming from the sun, you know, with a little sun thing, that can be that, you know? And so it flashes, at least for the first year or so, so that people get to know that, ah, there's a crosswalk. But the paddle, whenever I drive on King Street and there's that thing with the paddle for one person, so that one person crosses and it's red for another, whatever, long time. So I think it would really irritate people because it irritates me. So I'm sure other people would be irritated too. But if you have something that flashes, usually that takes your, you know, that brings your eyes to, oh, there's a panel there, something. So I think that would be better than a panel. And I also would prefer the location by Hampton because it would be easier for me rather than to have to go on that. It's a pretty small sidewalk on the Hampton side where the townhouses are. And, you know, I mean, it's pretty small. With my dog, it's even smaller. So in winter, it's even worse. So those are my concerns and advice and thinking and.
We appreciate hearing it.
Yeah.
May I ask? So, how often do you find yourself going into the street in order to cross the road?
Oh, at least once a day.
You're in the street.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because I take my dog for a walk, different places, you know, I go between the garage and the brewery, you know, in that big area there. So, crossing is always an adventure.
Well, it'll reduce the adventure aspect.
Yeah. And also, one more thing about the crosswalk at the location that is suggested now. Is that there's a big turn there, and people coming from Palm Street and Hampton Avenue, they just go fast, you know? And that might be hard for them to expect that sidewalk there when they're coming from the south. Follow what I'm saying?
From the other direction. Yep.
Mm-hmm. That's it.
Thank you. Any other questions for them?
No.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Would anyone else like to?
Hi, my name is Tamara Walter, and I live in Hamp. I moved here 8 years ago from the Bay Area and gave up my car. So I'm pretty familiar with the streets of Northampton. And there is definitely a culture that I respect the comment as a driver and understand about the expected part of placing a new crosswalk. But at the same time, I think that the culture of drivers here in Massachusetts and in Western Mass in particular needs encouragement and direction to slow down a little, to be more considerate of pedestrians. In that vein, I think that the idea of the speed bump, when I watched the speed bumps go in front of Jackson Street School, that just like totally changed the climate of that whole street, and the experience of being on Jackson Street went from one end to the other of the spectrum. When the four-way stop went in near the Y at the florist shop, it took having an officer there for a good week, I want to say, to help the drivers get it, that there was a change there. The signage was wonderful, but it didn't work well enough because people really are car driven. So if we really are going in the direction of encouraging walking, and I hope we are, then a speed bump, if that works for you, I don't know if that would.
Yeah, the speed bumps are fun.
Does it pose any kind of a danger to you, that unevenness?
No, it's fun. It's roller coaster.
Okay. So that would really help. Yes. All right.
I appreciate that. Thank you. Anyone else?
Susan Shapiro, I live at 20 Hampton Avenue, and I want to concur with earlier speakers that I think it would be much preferable to have the crosswalk in the like about 200 and 300 feet space, not only for convenience, but I do think that there is a sense of the curve there being a little bit of a blind spot for cars coming around. They don't really attend, you know, near the garage when they make that turn. And people coming out of the garage are often waiting and sometimes not patiently. So they want to go one way or the other. So I think it's a little bit of a choke pull place. However, if that's the only place where you would put a crosswalk, I would, like what Zane said, I would certainly go with it. It's certainly preferable to not having one. But I do think the other location would be safer. It would also be used more. And I know you already know this, but I'm just going to emphasize again that all year long it's important if we want to have access to Main Street. I usually at least go the back way, and I'll go all the way around to get to Main Street, go up through Thorns. I do shopping in Thorns and other places. If I have bags, and all year long, I have to be careful crossing. I'm relatively well abled, but you know, but I'm not as young as I once was, so I don't always balance well. But in the winter, it's really very, very difficult. And despite the fact that people are actually supposed to clear the way, there's often snow and ice, and it is treacherous. Dangerous is not too strong a word to use for any pedestrian, well, you know, body, able body or not. And so I encourage you to, yes, put in a crosswalk. I think it's actually very, very important. It will increase safety. And I do support the one that's within the 200 feet area. I think it will be safer if it's at all possible to do that. I think it would be preferable. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
My name is Roberta Pato. I also live in Hampton Court. I also think that that area, that 200 feet, probably would be preferable because more people cross there generally now, and changing people's habits might be a problem. However, I think that a crosswalk, no matter where you put it along that, in the preferred area or the other area, would be very important. Especially in the wintertime, even able people cross over and climb over mounds of snow, and you'd be required to at least shovel it out so that people can cross, and then people walk in the the road. They walk in the road and it's very hazardous and it's not always cleared up. So I think that a crosswalk is very important, not only for people who are disabled, but as well as for people who are able to be safe.
Any other public comment?
Can I just give you this copy from the email I got from Brookline?
Of course.
I read from
Mr. Lowenthal.
Hi, again, James Lowenthal, 181 Crescent Street. While you are not considering a stop light, a traffic control signal, which makes sense, I'm sure it wouldn't meet the warrants, and it costs $100,000, I would encourage you to consider putting in the policy that a speed hump, not a speed bump, but a speed hump or speed table always be considered, maybe as the default for mid-block crossings. It may be, the jury may be out, it may be inconclusive whether crosswalks are more dangerous or less dangerous, but what is not inconclusive, it's totally conclusive, that vertical deflections like speed humps or speed tables do slow traffic and improve safety. And we've heard testimony to that today, and I know that you all know how much better the culture is on Elm Street since the speed tables went in and the bump outs. So at least one or both of those should be, in my view, considered always for mid-block crossings. Either narrow it with bulb outs or curb extensions or bump outs, whatever you want to call them, and or raise speed tables or speed humps, because we know they work. And they're much cheaper than $100,000.
More expensive than a paddle.
Yes, except the paddles get stolen and then we have to buy more.
And they annoy people.
Any other comment from anyone who's come here today? No? Okay. Well, I'd like to shift back to the commission. Have our final discussion for today, at least, see what we want to decide or not decide, as the case may be. So I just turn it over to commission members.
So where is Hampton Avenue in terms of having the road redone? Because if we're talking about doing a raised crosswalk or a speed table or something like that, I assume it would make sense to do that at a time when road work was being done. So do we know where it is in the queue?
Jane Louise? I've been asking that question for a while. It's not on the list.
Okay.
Because there haven't been traffic counts. And as you probably know, the criteria is the volume versus the condition. So the higher the volume, the worse condition, the higher on the list. And I was told that Hampton Court is not on the list because there's no data. So now there's data.
Well, now we've got data, so maybe we can work on figuring out where it falls on the list. Because that might be a factor for if we were going to do some more significant work to create this mid-block crosswalk. We'd want to.
The pavement's in really lousy shape in that area, too, just west of the 400-foot crosswalk, right?
What'd you say?
The pavement and the street is in really poor condition.
The street is in terrible condition. Yeah. Big potholes.
That may make a lot of sense.
Maybe that's something we should look at as we're thinking about this.
Maggie, did you get any sense of whether or not Brookline had a policy that related to tables or speed bumps, humps, with regard to mid-block crossings?
I don't believe they have that as part of their policy. I don't remember seeing it. I would say, it's interesting to find out that the speed data that was collected is 20 to 22 miles per hour. It's pretty slow. I would have thought it would be, I would just assume it would be faster. And I guess for that reason, that increases my comfort level generally, because it's anything below 25 is sort of the magic number.
Can I ask I guess that's a testament to narrowing roadways. Slow speeds on a very narrow roadway. But what can you tell me, Ryan, because I don't understand exactly what the process here is on this. DPW has come to us with study on this crosswalk. Like, what comes next in this whole process? And how do we fit it into other general work?
That's a good question. I mean, this originated, of course, because residents brought forward an issue, and we've been grappling with how to address it. And what we did is try to do the best we can to use data and a method to figure out what to do. And that's what DPW has presented us with today. And it is a in recommendation form, but we're not required to do anything. You know, we're an advisory body. We're established as an advisory body. We don't make decisions about allocating city resources in any way. We just make recommendations. And so in my opinion, the questions before us are Hampton Avenue, but I think it's also a broader topic. And I realize that is kind of at odds with what some people may want, just to do one crosswalk and be done with it. I think it's a broader subject. You know, Director Fiden made the point that, you know, the whole policy has to, you know, it's good that we have more time to review the whole policy. So that's a long way of saying we can make a recommendation on this crosswalk today. We can not do so. We can gather more information and do it at a later time. But we're not required to do anything other than what we think we can do to set good policy.
If we were to look to doing something besides just fixing this real issue in terms of other issues, what are the kind of pieces of data that you would want to have in order to make a recommendation to whomever to set a policy up that permits looking at these on a regular basis so that decisions can be made in a more timely fashion, if you understand what I'm saying? If you don't have a policy, and you go through this every time. It seems to me it's a question that does come up periodically in the planning arena as well as in this one. So what additional kinds of information would you want in order to be able to make some kind of a next step?
What are you asking me?
Well, it's a generic you.
It's, you know.
Maybe I'm asking her.
She's clearly more knowledgeable than I am. You know, as I research this, I mean, you can find studies that contradict each other. You know?
Yeah.
The whole question of whether being in a crosswalk makes any difference at all statistically in terms of reducing collisions is a question that people have answered differently decade by decade. You can look at some studies, and it shows very clearly there's a statistically significant increase in the amount of collisions in marked as opposed to unmarked crosswalks. But that's for roads at a very high volume. So then there are these other considerations. What mitigation factors do we consider important? Speed tables, lighting, the width that we're painting, the kinds of paint we're using. It's almost an endless subject. So I guess it would be, I don't know that there is something we can do where we absolutely know we got the right answer, but we could study it further and reach a point where we're comfortable with the policy. Again, we're an advisory body. I mean, the DPW has their policy. We can't tell them what their policies are, but if we wanted, we could pursue that. We could look at other communities. I mean, Brookline has a policy, of course, but there are many other communities in Massachusetts and outside of Massachusetts that have. I think it's an important process. Yes, Don.
What more do you need to know?
Well,
I know it's the same question the lady asked.
I'm sorry.
It's the same question this lady asked.
Yes, it is. And I guess
what more? I mean, we can study things until, you know, we'll all be dead, and there still won't be a crosswalk.
I'm not making a recommendation that we do. I haven't made any recommendation. But it is, and again, this is, we're in the point now, we're back in the discussion, the transportation part. So I don't want, no, no, I don't.
Just, I want to.
Excuse me. We can open it back up for another period of public comment if you want.
I don't want to make a comment, I just.
Well, but you are commenting.
Well, there's a, there's a study, you were going to do a study of crosswalks.
Zane, if you don't mind, come up and please say.
I just want to remind you, this committee was going to do a study of crosswalks, and it kind of stalled. And then you hired an outside firm to combine it with the pedestrian bicycle study. And I guess it's ongoing. So a lot of the answers to that are forthcoming. I don't know when that study is going to be done.
Well, that's the ALTA study that you heard earlier. So
I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but they were supposed to look at crosswalks. They were supposed to take an inventory of crosswalks. You were going to do it here. You had some interns, and that didn't work out. So then it was pushed over to that, and.
Okay. I mean, you're correct that there is a consultant doing a study of crosswalks.
Yeah. So maybe it's a question of, you know, get them moving, get it out there. Maybe that'll answer a lot of the questions that you have. Like safety, for example. We were going to get that information from the police department, but they already did, so we backed off. How many fatalities, how many accidents can be documented in Northampton in crosswalks? So apparently they're doing it because they requested that information.
Okay, I guess we don't disagree on the point that we're doing research.
So Zane, so before you said that you felt like the question was still out on the stuff that you were researching, and now it also sounds like you'd like the ALTA information. So
are you advocating
that we
let's not talk over each other.
That we wait till we get those bits of information before we make.
Well, there's two things. I would appreciate this committee saying there needs to be a crosswalk in Hampton Court, and we're going to reserve judgment in terms of when and how, or where and how. I would appreciate that. But I also appreciate what you're saying about the overall policy. I mean, there's a lot of inconsistencies. There's a lot of crosswalks that are less than 200 feet apart. There are a lot of crosswalks that aren't, you know, they're sort of marked and haven't been maintained. There's a lot of information. So I agree that it would be good for this committee to really have a policy, to look at it thoroughly, so that every time somebody comes, you can really address it in a reasonable, logical way. So I'd like to see both things. I would like to see this commission say, yes, there needs to be a crosswalk on Hampton Court, and maybe you're not ready to say where or how to do it. But I think you have enough to know that it's needed. That's all.
Thank you.
Would anyone else like to continue any public comment? We've reopened it. Certainly welcome. Please, yeah, let's return.
Sorry, did you say?
No, I was going to say let's resume.
Okay. I have a question for Maggie. So many people have mentioned that sort of curve that happens on Hampton. And so when you were looking at the site distances, does that get factored in, or is that part of the criteria that you took from Brookline to sort of factor in that kind of curvature in a road that would affect sight lines?
Yes, I do the calculations on the site distances in the study.
Right.
So since people are dying about 20 to 22 miles an hour, and it's going to be 112 to 114 feet. Mm-hmm. So if you measure that off from the edge of the access road towards the brewery, they have that amount visible in front of them. Okay. I mean, there is a bit of a curve, yes, and I understand that people are worried about, you know, that blind curve going around the corner, but it says that people are going 20 to 22 miles, so I'm not as concerned.
Mm-hmm.
Since people are going slower, since they already know that people make turns to the parking garage.
And is there some way to factor in or measure, like when, you know, if you're turning onto Hampton from Pleasant Street, you're turning, right? Does that affect sight distance as opposed to if you're coming in the other direction from Old South, you're already on the road. So it's like if you're is it different when you're turning and then looking than if you're just going? Does that make sense? I'm just thinking about myself when I drive, that, you know, as you turn onto a road, you're suddenly in a new environment, right? Like you're on a different road as opposed to looking ahead of you on the road that you're already on. You can tell me it's completely not important, but
I'm not sure.
I think I see your point, Gina, because I mean, if at 30 miles an hour, there's a 196 foot sight distance, I think I'm reading that right, 200 feet, one or the other.
Yeah.
So you get the same sight distance at either the 200 or the 400 foot mark. So that actually
doesn't make any difference.
It doesn't make a difference, yeah, right? They're both legitimate, at least on that measure.
Mm-hmm. Any other thoughts? Course of action for today. Well, how does the commission want to leave this item today?
I'd move to make a recommendation to be happy to install a crosswalk and leave it to that, which spot they put it in. That, you know, in terms of location, I'm somewhat torn, but I think the policy is good. I think that the desire lines are really important. So in absence of data about where people walk, then the spot by the Kirkland Avenue extension, whatever we're calling it, makes sense. If there's really a lot more people crossing to WHMP, there's a logic because people are going to cross where they cross. But I defer. I think it should be a crosswalk somewhere, either spots or just my piece of a road light, that's the parking lot entrance, that's the avenue. I'd rather us just say it should be a crosswalk somewhere and leave it to Maggie to get a bigger spot. And then separately, we should keep discussions about what a policy is that we're.
Okay, so that's a motion. Is there a second to that?
I'd second that.
Okay, the motion is to recommend a crosswalk, but not give any recommendation about where the crosswalk is on that street. Is there any discussion about that?
Where does the ALTA study and all of that stuff play into this, and is there a need to wait?
Yeah, so I don't know what level, how deep in the weeds they're getting. They're going to be giving us their recommendations for what we should be doing differently about crosswalks. And so I don't know if they're going to say, oh, you're doing something wrong here, so they're going to focus a lot or not. We haven't seen a draft for that yet. So we're still going to share the drafts and get it. I'm not sure we're how deep in the weeds.
Do we know when that's coming?
Well, in theory, the whole project's supposed to be done September 29th. We got a no-cost extension from the feds if you give us the grant. So if they asked us for more time, we'd give it to them. At this point, they're alleging it.
Okay. Well, at that point, I mean, what's the difference between August and September 29th?
We're only 6 weeks out.
If, in fact, we could find useful data. And to the motion, I would probably oppose a motion to not specify a location, because I don't consider 200 feet to be a safe distance from what I. Again, my primary concern is safety. So.
I would also say that, you know, if one of our goals is to create a criteria for us going forward for mid-block crosswalks, that I would like to have that established for Northampton and have it apply to this one and not have this one be voted on before we've determined what that's going to be. That doesn't make sense to me.
Any other discussion to the motion? I mean, for the sake of discussion, will make a subsidiary motion to postpone the motion until we have data from ALTA, because that might really inform this decision and might lead to a policy.
I'm fine with throwing my motion. I do think in our discussions we need to think a lot about the desire lines, because I think the concern is. The problem I have with not allowing mid-block crossings is that, to me, there's no question that if we encourage people to an unsafe condition, we're drawing them to death. But I think sometimes we say, okay, therefore we're not going to do anything, and people are crossing anyway, and it's not safe. So I think we owe it to figure out a way to put a crosswalk here. But I'll find a way to save you get the information.
Okay. So, Director Flynn withdraws the motion. Is there a desire to make a more general motion that it's important that this commission play a role in developing criteria and that sort of encapsulating what you said in some way? Just a suggestion. Or not, we could just leave it and return to it. Okay. Okay. Well, if that's the kind of consensus, then maybe we don't even have to take a vote on something if there's no objection to continuing the discussion. Okay. All right. Well, then, without objection, we'll continue this to after we have data from all. Thank you. Well, we'll go back up. It's about 5 o'clock, right? 5:11. Oh, gosh. All right. So we'll go back up to item 8A. This is 16.135, an ordinance relative to a bus stop on Main Street for the purpose of moving the location of a bus stop on Main Street. Logically enough. And this comes from the Department of Public Works. It amends the code of ordinances, striking in section 312-114, schedule 13, bus stop, strikes Main Street north of Masonic Street, 0.75 westerly from Masonic Street, and inserts Main Street north Masonic Street, 0.65 feet westerly from Masonic Street. And I would defer to our traffic engineer to explain what that means.
Well, we had discussed at the previous meeting with PBTA to remove two spaces next to the stop in order to move this bus stop back to its original place for safety reasons. So they have given me this location, 65 feet less than the stop street.
That's what it does.
Yeah. Yes. How is, does it, a change in 10 feet move the bus stop 40 feet?
So they originally had it, this is from 2011, they had it from Masonic Street 75 feet westward, but we never moved the sign to that location. So it was always next in front of the church.
Okay.
But they're just changing it to 75 feet.
Got it.
Okay.
Don't look in the mirror. Okay. Is there a motion on this?
Just one very minor thing. So because the council rules, this should be on the recommendation of the committee once we make the change.
Oh.
Otherwise, council referred back to us.
We don't have to do that.
I think you referred to the committee automatically unless it was upon the recommendation.
Nope.
Okay. Never mind.
We can make it you.
I
can add the word direct. I'm looking at the other one. Okay. Is there a motion on this, first of all, for a recommendation?
Just did them all at once.
What's that?
Can you just do them all at once?
Make a motion to take both of these ordinances as a group.
Yeah.
Okay. For a positive recommendation, I assume.
Great. Yeah.
What?
And the old telephone?
Is it?
They're
unrelated, I think.
Yeah, they're unrelated. Okay. I'm curious to talk about the old telephone.
Okay. Motion on this ordinance for a positive right.
Motion.
Direct motion. Is there a second?
16.135.
Second.
Thank you. Great. Any further discussion on positive recommendation? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Thank you very much.
Is the sign getting moved?
What's that?
Is the sign getting moved?
Someone's going to move. After this, we go out. Unscrew it, Erwin. All right, 16.136, an ordinance relative to parking on Old South Street. For the purpose of amending on-street parking meter zones, parking prohibited areas, and 15-minute limited-time parking rules for Old South Street. And there is a map that accompanies this ordinance. Is your desire for me to waive the reading of the ordinance, which is a series of numbers?
Yes.
I will not read it. Because it is in the public record. And for our traffic engineer, please explain this to me.
Basically, if you look at section 2, parking prohibited all times, it says there's no parking from South Street to 110 feet southerly from Main Street. That's basically the entire section. It says no parking. So I'm making edits where there's metered parking, is that 15-minute parking space, more metered parking, and then the addition of a parking space between Booster Court and Hamp.
Please.
Didn't we have a discussion about a bus idling there for
period of time, and I think we voted against it, but the bus still idles there. So is this parking spot going to keep the bus that we voted against having idling there from idling?
So City Council approved the bus there. That was the NASS bus.
We did? Okay.
But then NASS changed their route. Okay. So they're now stopping by Academy Music and doesn't need to stop there.
Okay.
So are we actually installing a meter? Do I understand it correctly? Seems like don't. We are?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
There's not a space there now. So we create one.
Okay.
And put a meter?
I think so. This kind of partially with our discussion with the PVTA bus stop move, where we said, you know, sometimes we're going to lose spaces for PVTA, but whenever we can regain spaces to sort of balance it, we should. So just a minor formatting thing. We actually shouldn't have people's names on the recommendation. So either drop my name or replace it with planning and sustainability, but don't put me first.
Okay. Friendly amendment without objection. We'll strike Wayne Fiden's name. But first, this is really an amendment, nothing. Do we have a motion on this? I forgot. I don't think so. Someone make a motion for positive recommendation.
Positive recommendation.
Second. Second. Okay. Any further discussion with the amendment? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Thank you very much. Item 9B is removed from the agenda, partially because I made a minor error in posting the incorrect address for 129 Pleasant Street, but mostly because I actually spoke to some of the people who were going to come here tonight. And originally, what Director Pomerantz and I thought was they were going to request permanently moving, eliminating parking spaces on Pleasant Street, and permanently moving or temporarily moving a bus stop. The bottom line is the construction for the affordable housing, the Hamp project on Pleasant Street, all this stuff is going to be temporary, just part of the construction. So there's really no policy question for the Transportation Parking Commission. It's more about how do we accommodate construction. So that's why it's removed. Item 9C, motorcycle and compact car parking ordinances, includes Councilor Scherer.
Well, the two other members that were interested in talking about this are not here today, which are the chief and also Nancy Forrestal. They were both interested in us sort of opening up a discussion about whether we'd like to create ordinances for like smaller. This all stemmed from removing the 15-minute spot in front of the drive, or right next to the driveway for the police station. And the question was, well, actually, you know, maybe if it was smaller, like that could be made a motorcycle parking spot. That would be fine. That because that wouldn't. The problem was that they couldn't coming off the deck. They couldn't see very well. If they're on a motorcycle, they could be able to see. So. They're interested in kind of opening up a discussion about whether we wanted to create a policy for having motorcycle parking in locations where it's not big enough for a car, but we can put a motorcycle spot. Or additionally, whether we want to look at compact parking spots for, you know, smaller vehicles. So I don't know if we want to postpone that since they're not here, or if we want to just kind of briefly talk about whether this is something that we want to pursue and figure out how to. You know, figure out what other communities do with these kind of size spots.
Task a staff person who to provide, get some material, just moves the process along. Mm-hmm. Looking for parking places is an issue, and a motorcycle is parking in something that they don't have to be parking, and they could be a little further down the street. That's probably not a bad move.
Right. And I was looking over our code, and in our code, you can have more than one motorcycle in a parking spot, but they don't necessarily do that. Mm-hmm. So if they had sort of designated smaller spots, that might be easier.
In front of Bard's, maybe.
Which doesn't exist.
I think it's a very worthwhile topic of discussion. Any other discussion today? I'll certainly continue with it.
I mean, do we want to see if the DPW could look into regulations? I hate to keep you guys waiting.
Is that just kind of agree to do that? Maybe.
Yeah, why not? I mean, I think any sort of alternative vehicle parking there, motorcycle, scooter, bicycle, or otherwise, I think it's a wise idea.
So the DPW can bring some thoughts perhaps to future meeting. Thank you. Okay, so move on from this one. This is another Councilor Sherwin. 9D, pedestrian and general safety on Burskett Road and related issues.
A constituent contacted me who and also Wayne about the curve on Burt's Pit right when you go past the Smithvoke agricultural land, or actually it's still in that along that land. There's a pretty significant curve, and there are a lot of people that run there or bike there. And it's a very narrow road. It doesn't have a shoulder. It has a lot of runoff, so there's ruts in it, and it's just not a very safe location. And so actually, Director Liscali and I went up there yesterday and looked around, just because there's some, like the ideal would be that eventually create some sort of section, you know, to the side where you'd have designated runner bike path or something like that. But for the immediate future, what we saw is that there really isn't any signage there that kind of indicates to that, you know, to slow down or to be aware that there are pedestrians or bicyclists or whatever. So hopefully Director Scott can talk about it, but we should have some good ideas.
Sure, we talked about this when we talked about it with David Love. So a couple of things. The signage that's there, it has been damaged over time. There's like arrows that tell you there's a curb or lead over, so that would be kind of the first thing you want to straighten those up. There's also speed limit signs that are missing. I think Maggie, correct me if I'm wrong, it should be 25 miles an hour around that curb, correct?
Right, 20 miles an hour.
20 miles an hour.
They may have been knocked over in the past.
So we're going to reinstall the 25 or the 20, and there's also not a winding sign, you know, the sign with the curve on it. So anyway, there's not one of those signs on an approach from the other side, not the field side, the far side. So we're going to fix all of that signage and kind of see what that does, and hopefully that will solve some of our immediate problems. I think it's just a visibility thing.
Wayne, I don't know if you have any comments about it. This sounds like something that you've been looking at for a long time, or it's sort of been a topic of concern for a while.
Yeah, but as you said, mine's more sort of in the 10-year time period.
Right.
So we've looked, you know, we've been working on getting the rail trail connections up to the state hospital. And so long-term is, can we extend the trail which goes to the state hospital between the community gardens and the hillside and cut through so you sort of avoid that a high point is called the Drumlin.
Mm-hmm.
So you sort of go over before the Drumlin's so high.
Mm-hmm.
It's a wooded area. But that's, I mean, just as clear, we need Department of Ag Resources approval, Smithvoke, we'd have to go to the state legislature and we need money to build it. So yes, it's a 10 or 20 year plan, but this is great. It's much shorter.
Anything else? Okay. Thank you. Next is discussion item 50-minute parking space next to the police station on Center Street and discussion of potential additional spot on Center Street in front of First Churches. That's a council issue.
So the 15-minute spot that was right next to the parking, right next to the lot for the police station is gone, which is great. What hasn't happened yet is that the spot in front of that is supposed to be made into a 15-minute spot. So if we could turn that into, that's part of the ordinance that we passed, had called for that next spot to be 15 minutes. So I think the police department is very happy that that 15-minute spot's gone. I've now had multiple residents from that road contact me because they use that 15-minute spot to unload groceries because they don't have parking spots of their own. So if we can get a 15-minute spot there, they will be very, very happy. Additionally, we've sort of been talking about whether we could fit another spot kind of in front of First Churches. And I tried to do some research and I couldn't find when, there had been another spot there, I believe, or I couldn't find when that had been changed. So I don't know if I need to do some deeper research. It wasn't in our code, but.
That has something to do with changing crosswalks. It seems to me I remember
right.
a discussion where there had been changes in the crosswalks, which changed the.
I think that that's right. Mm-hmm. When they did the construction, they mm-hmm. changed where the crosswalk location was. And it still actually goes into, they may have changed it, but actually Chief Casper and I were looking at it, and it still kind of goes directly into a parking spot, so it's not an ideal location now anyway. So I still don't have an answer on that. And I think someone from the DPW had gone and measured it to see if there was room. Maybe David had measured it, but he's not here, so I don't know the answer. But whether there actually is enough space to put a parking spot there. Because there is also a fire hydrant. So that's the question. So I'll dig deeper.
So those crosswalks, those diagonal crosswalks that currently go into a parking space were supposed to be temporary during the construction of the location. They're not supposed to be there now.
So is that another like mid-block crosswalk conversation we need to have?
No.
It sounds like it's paint. This seems to be painted out or something. Or ground up.
Or is there value?
Right, or is there
a mid-block crosswalk? It's not for a policy.
Right.
If it's already there, do a whole study.
I don't think we need to study it. I mean, you
right.
could. You could see how it's used and so forth.
Go back to that parking space. So you're not supposed to have a parking space within 10 feet of a fire hydrant. Mm-hmm. There's 34 feet from the back of that space to the fire hydrant. However, if we put a parking space there, the road is narrower there
mm-hmm.
than on the State Street side.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm afraid putting a parking space there would be too narrow for two lanes of traffic.
Hmm. Interesting. Okay. That goes back to my question about whether there was one there at one point.
I don't know.
Quite commonly, they park illegally there too, and that's a choke point. It would be a choke point. It is narrower going up towards Main from the station. So, I mean, it's they're the nice. The buses park there too for the show. It's, you know, we try to give some leniency, but it's hard sometimes.
Can you get one motorcycle right next to the entrance to the police station?
I would say you could get multiple, and that surprises me that I'd say that. But yeah, that spot would put more than one in there. If the visual would be gone, you'd still be able to see. Hard to get out of there. Center Street can be hard responding to an emergency. So that's why we really appreciate that opening up that space. Yes, putting something in there that would be two-wheel operated, that would be, in my opinion, and the Chief's, fine.
So, well, I mean, can we temporarily put a bag over one of the meters and call it a 15-minute space?
Does that work?
I don't know.
Do people read the bag?
Well, put the bag on and then the metal sign attaches to the post.
Yeah, there you go.
If the DPW, you just put the sign on.
That would make more sense.
They would know not to pay and the sign would indicate 15 minutes.
So that's something we'll city departments.
Okay.
Anything else on this? No? Okay. 10A is another 15-minute space on Market Street. This is sort of at the request of the Quick Workspace folks. This is probably something I should have done, which I didn't do. I think we need measurements here to bring an ordinance forward. So maybe I can begin to put an ordinance together and confer with the DPW whenever you're able to. Maybe help with measurements. I believe we made a recommendation that we want.
Yes.
Like a conceptual record.
And it had to do with the fact that you could stick it in a place where the alley or something comes back out so that it would be easy to slide in and
yeah,
out.
Right.
You wouldn't have to back into it if it's fast, if it's a fast turnaround space, you could slide into
right.
it.
more easily.
Okay.
I think I remember that discussion.
Okay. That's just something that I didn't do, so we'll do that and bring it to a future meeting. Nothing else on that. Recommendation, this is a holdover from last time, recommendation relative to city policy regarding gender-neutral roadwork signs. We're sort of looking into that. If there's any updates?
Yes, so after an inventory, it has been determined that we have 3 men working signs.
Wow.
Entire DPW, which are easily replaced.
Excellent. Okay.
That's excellent. Thank you.
What's your replacement with?
They will be replaced with a picture of a person with a shovel.
No text?
No text.
No text.
Some of them, we have actually several different signs. We have like mowing ahead, utility work ahead, and then we have the picture of the person with no text.
Person working.
Because for language barrier reasons, you know, sort of a visual representation was better than it was. So we kind of have put several different options, but there's still some holdovers that the water department has. It's like them working. So those will be replaced. Make timely note.
Just say workers.
Workers in there.
Either way, someone's going to put an Andre the Giant sticker on it at some point. So it doesn't really matter.
Yeah, I'll mention that there is also, you know, contractors and,
right,
you know, National
right.
Grid. And I think there's, say, utility work ahead. But, you know, there could be folks unaffiliated with the city who do continue to use my work.
And it would probably be a bridge too far to require as part of the contracts that we allow to use gender neutral. And no one would want to just be another thing worth answering. We'll say the removal of the ones that we own is definitely a problem. So thank
set
you very
an
much.
Example.
We'll set an example. Okay. C is another holdover. Issues, city regulations, and ordinances relative to taxis, livery vehicles, ride sharing, such as Uber. This was on, you recall, a representative from a cab company came and brought these issues up. Since then, I know there's been discussion. Director Fyde expressed interest after the meeting. Perhaps others, in seeing if we can work on updating our taxi ordinance. And also, if I'm not mistaken, I believe state legislation passed regarding ride sharing, although I haven't reviewed it. So things have happened, so maybe this item is more about if we want to move forward with revising these things, what's the best way to do it? Now that we're all in open session here, do we want to form like a little working group that's less than a quorum of the committee? Is that something that should be decided outside of this meeting? My recommendation is that maybe what I will do is I will go to a couple of the city department heads who express interest. Maybe we can bring a draft, work on a draft, and actually bring something to this commission. Just go from there and have something to actually work with. But it was good to know that there's is interest in revising this ordinance. Okay, so that's what I'll do. All right, this is a holdover again, crosswalk and general issues near 126 West Street. That's the crosswalk near the levee near Smith College. And someone came and presented this to us, and I believe she was going to look up an old Pioneer Valley planning commission study.
It's actually a Smith College study.
Oh, was it?
They invited planning DPW to them. It was their study.
Okay. Did you ever get a copy of that?
I never heard back from her. So.
Okay. All right, so that's...
Would they get a copy when it was done?
Well, did you hear? You didn't hear
from I never heard back from her. I probably got a copy at the time years ago, but...
Is it locatable? Or is it
yeah.
Oh, okay.
You want me to do that to you?
Sure, please.
I mean, I think I had some.
Yeah, I'm not sure there's anything else we can do on that today, so.
Okay.
Move on. And that's it. Any new business today? All right, if not, is there a motion to adjourn?
Move to adjourn.
Second? I'll second.
There you go.
All in favor? Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you very much.